Today, I want to talk about despair, and I want to suggest that despair is not necessarily as negative as it sounds. I'm talking particularly about the kind of despair that can arise fairly commonly after awakening. I'm contacted regularly, both by emails and in one-to-one sessions, by people who are having an uncomfortable time, let's say, after an awakening. And often a part of the discomfort that they're experiencing is a feeling of despair. Now, there's a fairly simple reason why it's quite likely that an initial awakening may leave us in a state of some despair. Because in an awakening, it's seen that there is no one, and therefore there is no one who can do anything about the dilemma that they feel that they are in because they feel separate. You see, before awakening, there may always have been hope. There may have been hope that I can do something about my dilemma. Whatever that may be, if I'm spiritually inclined, it might be to meditate, follow a guru, follow a spiritual path, become a Buddhist and practice mindfulness. The problem with awakening, and one of the reasons that an awakening event can be so shattering for the person, is that realization, because the realization that because there is no one here, and I'm pointing again deliberately to what appears to be a solid person here, that the realization that because there is no one here, there is no one who can do anything about the dilemma of feeling separate. And so a common reaction to this, we could say, is a feeling of hopelessness, a feeling of despair, a feeling that I am somehow still trapped in separation. I know that there is something, or I have an apprehension that there is something that somehow I am not getting, I might put it like that. But the hope that I can do something about that has gone. So after an awakening, what can quite often happen is that, for example, my spiritual practices may fall away, my reading of spiritual books may fall away, and nevertheless, still, there's a feeling that I am here and I am stuck and there is nothing that I can do about this. I developed what I call the great mantra. It came to me one day while I was listening to somebody else talking about non-duality in a meeting, and into my head came the words of the great mantra, as I call it, and those words are hopeless, helpless, and meaningless. And if ever there was a cry of despair, that sums it up. I cried this mantra out into the audience because I felt that it was so relevant. And in the tea break that followed later, somebody that I knew came up to me and they put their arm around my shoulder and they said, "Richard, that was the most depressing thing that I have ever heard." And I started to sort of automatically apologize to them for having brought this into their life. And they said, "Oh, no, it was wonderful." And this is my feeling about it, that the great mantra of helpless, hopeless, and meaningless is actually quite a wonderful realization. And that although despair, we're kind of conditioned to think of despair as a very, very, very negative thing, what I want to suggest is that actually despair is not necessarily the horror that it appears to be. We're sort of conditioned to feel that we must live in hope and avoid despair. I'd like to suggest that in a way it's hope that is the cruelest thing, and despair in a strange way can be a comfort. Anyway, whatever orientation we take to despair, it's quite likely that it may fall upon us after an awakening, as there is the realization that something has been glimpsed which seems incomparably precious, incomparably lovely, but that glimpse has then been snatched away, and what has replaced it is the realization that because there is no person here, there is no one that can do anything about the dilemma that the separated person still feels themselves to be in. And that's why we may feel that, okay, life now is meaningless. Once I believed perhaps that life had a meaning, whatever that meaning might be, perhaps I believed that the meaning of life was to serve God, perhaps, or the meaning of life was to work through my karma, or the meaning of life was to serve others. And now all sense that life has a meaning has gone, and it has been replaced perhaps simply by the realization that life simply is. And I may feel hopeless in my dilemma that I still feel separate, where once perhaps I felt that my daily meditations might bring me one step each day closer to the Godhead, whatever word I might use. Now there's the recognition that nothing that I can do can get me out of my dilemma, because I indeed do not exist. And then meaningless, yes, the realization that everything is simply without meaning, everything simply is. Now, when the person has finally been seen through, what I want to suggest is that it is partly precisely the recognition of the meaninglessness of everything that makes it so glorious. The recognition that nothing needs to have a meaning, that everything again simply is, in its fascination. One of the problems with meaning is that meaning is always a mental construct, and so meaning always takes us away from the immediacy of what is. And by the immediacy of what is, what I mean is whatever appears to be happening: the sound of a voice, the color of a picture that we're looking at, the texture of a cat's fur, the smell or the taste of a cup of coffee, whatever is arising immediately. And meaning, because meaning consists of mental constructs, it tends to take us away from immediacy. So the recognition that this is meaningless, this is meaningless. Another way of putting that is that it's the recognition that it does not need to have a meaning. And perhaps if we put it that way, we can hear the positive in that rather than the negative in that. This does not need to have a meaning. This is already so rich and so full that no meaning that we could assign to it could add anything to it. Now, human beings, by and large, tend to be addicted to meaning. I have called human beings meaning-seeking missiles. So it's very likely that in our sense of separation, we will try to make sense of existence, of what seems to be our existence, by assigning it some kind of meaning. It might be a religious meaning, it might be a philosophical meaning, it might be an existential meaning, but probably we will either assign some meaning to existence or believe that there is some meaning to be discovered, even if it has not yet been assigned. So on a simple level, we may simply believe in, let's say, you know, redemption through a creator God, and that will give meaning perhaps to many aspects of our life. Or on a more sophisticated level, we may go in search of some mysterious meaning which we have not yet found, and yet we feel somehow lurks out there somewhere. Now, in awakening, it's quite possible that all of that will collapse, because everything that I've just mentioned in terms of meaning is, of course, simply a story. It's just an invention of the mind. And if that collapses, and it's seen that there is just this, well, yes, there may be despair, but there may also be relaxation. Despair and hope are clearly opposites. And again, we are usually conditioned to feel that hope is good and that despair is bad and is to be avoided. Now, the problem with hope, though, is that hope is a very, very hard taskmaster. As long as there is hope, as long as we have hope, then there is always something that we can be doing and perhaps should be doing in order to get us closer to some imagined goal. So hope can be very, very tiring indeed. And I've quoted before the John Cleese character in the film Clockwise, who in his desperate attempts, in his frantic attempts to connect with the woman of his dreams, the plans and schemes that he makes, which are constantly falling apart, at one point he cries out, "It's not the despair, I can stand the despair, it's the hope that I cannot stand." So hope is very tiring. Hope is very pushy. Hope can exhaust us. And as long as there's hope, there's always something that you could be and should be doing. You could be and should be doing. Now, if hope disappears, and it's quite likely to disappear in the recognition that I am nothing, if it's replaced then with despair, there is truly nothing I can do about my predicament because I do not exist, then it's quite likely that at the very least there may be a gentle sigh of relief, a kind of exhalation, a kind of sound. It's quite likely that there may be at last some relaxation that can arise. So this is a very, very common phenomena, this feeling of despair, this feeling that somehow I feel like I'm still here, I still feel stuck in this existence, and yet there's the recognition that no prayers, no holy mantras, no techniques, no steps along the spiritual path any longer offer a solution to this. So all I can do really is sit. All I can really do is sit in my despair. Well, sitting in my despair may be relaxing. And if despair feels too much, if it feels like it's overwhelming us, what to do? Well, do something simple. Do something very simple. Do something, anything, which is the least little bit enjoyable. when I went through periods of despair, I used to phone Tony Parsons, and Tony Parsons would listen to me, and he would then suggest that I did something very simple indeed. He might say something like, do you drive, Richard? I say, yes, I drive. But do you enjoy driving? Yes. Well, why don't you go and have a drive? Have a drive in the country, something like that. I'm paraphrasing here, of course. And at the time, there was a part of me that thought, this is very banal. I don't want to hear this. I want to receive some kind of much deeper wisdom than this. But nevertheless, I acted on this, I'll call it advice. And what do you know? It helped. It actually helped. And I began to realize that actually this is very sound advice indeed. So, yeah, if despair arises, it arises. Perhaps sit in it. Perhaps in some ways it might even be a little bit enjoyable. But then when there's been enough sitting in it, well, just get up and do something simple. Get up and do something else. Whatever it may be for you. A walk in the sun or a walk in the rain, a drive in the country or a drive in the town. Sit the cat on your lap if you have one and stroke the cat, read a book, watch a little bit of television, anything that's a little bit relaxing. But the main thing I think I want to say and the main thing that I want to leave this episode on is that in a sense, you know, you are not alone. There's a cliche. You are not alone. But I very much mean this. I very much mean this. If you have experienced this or you are experiencing this, it's a common reaction, I might say, a common reaction to an awakening where we might say that there's been the seeing of or the realization of the emptiness of everything and the emptiness of the self, but there hasn't yet been a recognition or a seeing of the fullness of everything. Yes, the self is non-existent. The self is always eternally empty. But this existence, this apparent existence, is not just empty, it's also full. But until that fullness is seen, there may be a living for a while in despair. Or if there is, find something simple and enjoyable to do and do it. And I wish you well.